it is only temporary. Tell somebody, it is only temporary. Temporary means lasting for only a limited of time. Lasting for only a limited of time. Everything here in this world is based on limited time. It's all temporary. Everything in this world. Eternity is only wired in our hearts, not in things. Ecclesiastes 3:11, he has made everything beautiful in his time. Also, he has put eternity in their hearts, except that no one can find out the work that God does from beginning to the end. He placed eternity in our hearts, not in things that we see. Why? 2 Corinthians 4:18 says, why we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. So everything you see in this world is temporary. So, as human, just to recap from part one, as human, we are wired to seek happiness. Everybody wants happiness. So God wired us to seek happiness. And God did it such a way that the only place we can find that happiness is in him. Until you meet the Lord, you cannot have a lasting happiness. You cannot have a lasting joy until you meet with Jesus. There is nowhere in the world where you can have satisfaction. No matter how comfortable that place may be, you cannot have rest for your soul until you meet with Jesus. It's been confirmed. You cannot have rest for your soul. You cannot have a lasting joy until you meet with Jesus. I'm very proud of that. Matthew chapter 11, 28 to 30 says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. And you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So the only way you can have rest is come to Jesus Christ. There are challenges in this world, but in Jesus Christ, the burden is light. The yoke is very easy. So this is the key. You live for the Lord, you will be fulfilled. If you live for Jesus, you will be fulfilled. You live for yourself, and you will, at the end of life, regret and unfulfilled. Anybody who lives for himself in this world or for herself, at the end of life, will regret it. You will never be fulfilled. You live for the Lord, you will be fulfilled. At the end of life, people regret more on the things they're supposed to do and did not do, more than the things that they did and thought, I wouldn't have done this. What you left undone will bring greater regret at the end of life. Think about Jesus. The challenge is that life does not have roadmap, manual, or GPS. So, but for you to navigate your way through life, listen, you must align your life around your passion for the Lord. That's the only way out. Around the best thing you do and you are happy for the Lord. Align your life around your passion for the Lord. You must discover your passion and align your life around this passion. Then God will lead you through all the way. When you have him, you don't need any roadmap or any GPS. You know, if you are going somewhere, somebody wants to give you a roadmap or the way to go around that place. Maybe you are on a vacation and the tour guide is saying, is telling you, do you want me to go with you and show you everywhere or give you a paper that you can follow or a map that you can follow to go to wherever you want to go and enjoy this trip? Which one are you going to take? I want the tour guide. I don't want the paper that I'll be reading, wasting my time. I want the tour guide. So Jesus Christ is the author. He wants to be with you all the way. So you don't need the roadmap again. If Jesus is with you, you don't need any GPS. Live for the Lord and you will be fulfilled. Amen. Let's go to part two. It is only temporary. And I want to ask you this question. How many of us want this life to be temporary? Raise up your hand, let me see. You want this life we are here to be temporary? Oh, how many of us want it to be permanent? Why? Okay, we're going to see the reason today. You see, this is the way God designed it after the fall. After we fell in the Garden of Eden, after our parents, after they did what God said they must not do, something happened. Look at Genesis chapter 3 from verse 22. Genesis chapter 3 from verse 22 says, "Then the Lord God said, Behold, the man has become like one of us, to know good and evil. And now, lest he put out his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore, the Lord God sent him out of the Garden of Eden to till the ground which he was taking. So he drove out the man, and he placed cherubim at the east of the Garden of Eden, and flaming sword which turned every way to guide the way to the tree of life." So after we fell in the garden, this is what God did. God drove man out of the Garden of Eden so that man will not go and place his hands on the fruit of the tree of life. Because if man should do that, what do you think is going to happen? Man will not have opportunity to repent. Man will be permanently a sinner. Man will be permanently derailed. We continue forever. We continue forever. Amen. Amen. So because of that, God drove man out of the garden. God drove man out of the garden. And after he drove man out of the garden, because see, after man fell, everything changed. Wickedness came to being. Man became a rebellious person. Can you imagine? Even after God drove man, listen to me this very carefully, from his love, he drove us out of the garden so that we are not going to eat the fruit of life. Because if we place our hands on the fruit of life and we eat it, we will never die. We will never have a physical death. We will remain as we are in our situation. And look at the wickedness we have in the world today. Will have been permanent. There will be no way to change. Now, not only that God drove man out of the garden, God placed a cherubim at the east gate and so that man will not return back, because man is very stubborn. After we fell, we will go against the will of God. We will go against the plans of God. God said, these people can come back. Let me guard the entrance to the garden so that God, from his love, he protected us from being who we are as a sinner, as a rebellious person, as a wicked person. He prevented us from remaining like that forever. It is only temporary. The situation you may find yourself is not permanent. Any situation you may be right now, even if you are a sinner, you have the opportunity, it is not permanent. For Christians, as we are going to see this morning, is good, better, best for us as Christians. Good, better, best. The best is yet to come. We always hope for the best. We are going to see this morning. So the fallen world is full of evil and wickedness. So to be permanent is not good. That's why I supported those of you that said you don't want it to be permanent. The wickedness in this place is, there's no word to describe the wickedness in the heart of man. The thinking of man every day is wickedness. We are so wicked. The only difference we can make is Christ. If Christ is in us, that is the only difference we can make. We are so wicked. And our thinking every day is wickedness. The way we reason, the way we do our things is different, as we are going to see this morning. Can you imagine if Adolf Hitler is still alive today? Can you imagine if Stalin is still alive today? Can you imagine if people like Abasha, if people like him, if they are still alive today? Can you imagine? Let's look at the wickedness of man and see that God decided to make it temporary so that there will be a way out. First and foremost, check Herod. Check Herod. When Jesus was born and the Magi came to visit Jesus and the parents, and they visited Herod, the angel of the Lord came to the Magi and told them, don't go back to him and report to him about the child that was born. Matthew chapter 2, look at from verse 13. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise, take the young child and his mother, flee to Egypt and stay there until I bring you word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. When he arose, he took the young child and his mother and flee and his mother by night and departed for Egypt and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, out of Egypt I called my son. Look at verse 16. Then Herod, when he saw that he was deceived by the wise men, the Magi, was exceedingly angry, and he sent forth and put to death all the male children who were in Bethlehem and in all his district, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had determined from the wise men. Then was fulfilled. Forget about the other one. Look at what Herod did. Look at the wickedness I'm talking about. Look at why it got to be just temporary. Herod, because a child was born, and he was thinking this child might be greater than himself, decided to kill every boy from 2 years old and down, because he was aiming at one person. I want us to look at this very carefully. Is that not a wickedness? It is only temporary. If people like Herod are still living today, can you imagine what this world will look like? But look at the patience of God. God was so patient. Do you know that God had power to kill Herod right there? But what did he do? He said, he appeared to Joseph and said, take the child, take Jesus to Egypt and stay there. God was so patient. Jesus stayed in Egypt with his parents until when? Until when Herod died. Even though Herod killed so many children, he was not able to kill Jesus. Listen to me. Everyone that is after your destiny, everyone that is after your life, the Lord that fought for Jesus will fight for you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. No one can stop the plans of God for your life. Amen. Nobody can stop your destiny if you live for the Lord. You will fulfill your destiny. I learned so many lessons in this case of Herod, the case of Jesus, the Magi. I learned so many things. I am not against you if you are praying that your enemy must die right now. I'm not against you. You can pray it. But God's plan for your life will continue either your enemy is dead or your enemy is alive. God allowed Herod to be alive. He said, okay, take Jesus. Take him to Egypt to run away from the enemies. God did not kill Herod. Herod died naturally. After he was dead, what did God told Joseph? Take the child back to Israel. Look at verse, check verse 19. Now when Herod was dead, of that Matthew chapter 2, right? Then when Herod was dead, when he saw that he was deceived by, verse 19. Now when Herod was dead, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, arise, take the young child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who sought the young child's life are dead. All those that are seeking the death of your children, those that are seeking your destruction to stop you from fulfilling your purpose, that Lord will take care of them as he took care of the enemies of Jesus in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Just understand, it's only temporary. Whatever challenge you are facing, God knows it's only temporary. God sees everything. When you have Jesus, you don't need any GPS. You don't need any roadmap. You don't need any manual of life. He is all in all. He will help you and see you through. He will help you and see you through. So, then he arose, took the young child and his mother, and came into the land of Israel. Look at the case of Pharaoh. Look at another wickedness. That is why it's only temporary. I never prayed that this life we are in should be permanent. Because so many wicked things going on around the corner. Even in our time, look at Pharaoh. Look at what he did. Exodus chapter 1. Later, from verse 15, later the king of Egypt spoke to the Hebrew wives, midwives, one of whom was named Shephora, and the other Pua. Verse 16, when you have the Hebrew women give birth, he said, wash them as they deliver. If it's a son, kill him. But if it's a daughter, let her alive, let her live. Verse 17, but the midwife feared God and didn't do what the king of Egypt told them. Instead, they let the boys live. When the king of Egypt called for the midwives, he asked them, why have you done this and allowed the boys to live? Then they lied to him. Hebrew women are it like Egyptian women, they said. The midwives replied to Pharaoh, they are so healthy and they give birth before the midwives arrive to help them. Verse 20, God was pleased with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. Because the midwives feared God, he provided families for them. Meanwhile, Pharaoh continued commanding all of his people, you are to throw every Hebrew son who is born into the Nile River, but you are to allow every Hebrew daughter to live, to stop the plans of God for his people. Nobody can stop the plan of God for you. Amen. If you look very carefully at the case of the Israelites, let's pause a minute. Look at the map. Look at the geographical map of Israel. Are you with me now? Look at the geographical map of Israel. Israel is surrounded by Libya, Yemen, Syria. I don't want to make mistakes. Syria. Iraq. So we have Syria, Iraq, Yemen, Libya, surrounding that little place called the land of Israel. Check it very carefully now. Syria is in a big trouble, right? It's a wanton place. Iraq is still passing through wars since the time Iraq was invaded. In fact, since 1990, when first Bush invaded Iraq, they never come out of it. Then the second Bush went in there. They are still suffering now. It's a wartime place now. Look at Yemen. What is going on in Yemen now? And look at Libya. What is going on in Libya? All those nations, they said they will never allow Israel to leave. They join hands together and say, you will never survive in this place. But what is happening? They are the one not surviving. Everyone that join hands together and say, we are not going to survive. What happened to these nations will happen to them, the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Nobody can stop the plans of God for his people. Nobody can stop the plans of God for his people. We are going to see about 40 people. Look, we are in a world of wickedness. People are wicked. 40 people, they join themselves together. They join hands together. We are going to read it. They join hands together and they said, we are not going to eat nor drink until Paul is dead. Until Apostle Paul is what? Dead. They said, we are not going. Let's read it together. Let me go there quickly. And then we're going to find a way to pray. If I can get it, I think I should be able to get it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Devil is a liar. Who is a liar? Devil is a liar. There is no one who can stop the plans of God for your life. When they join hands together, they will fail. Because the Lord is on the throne. The Lord loves his people. When God plans for his people, he has the capacity to execute that plan. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Is that this? It's Acts of the Apostle. No, Acts of the Apostle, chapter 23. Acts 23, from verse 12. I will just quickly read this. And when it was day, some of the Jews banded together and bound themselves under a oath. Look at this now. Saying that they would neither eat nor drink till they had killed Paul. You never know people that are binding themselves together to say they will never eat nor drink until they stop you. Oh, he has gone to America. We must make sure we destroy him. They will bind themselves under oath. They may be the so-called best friend. They may be the so-called members of the family. They may be the so-called workers, the same. They may be the so-called neighbors in their neighborhood. They may be the same people that you hit together. The heart of man is desperately wicked. Who can know it? People you sleep with, people you wake up with, people you walk around with, they can bind themselves and say, this one is too happy, this one has too much of joy, it's too easy for this one, we will bind ourselves together until we frustrate this one. But God is on the throne. It's only temporary. They will not succeed. Amen. In the mighty name of Jesus, they will not succeed. Amen. Everyone that seeks your heart will not succeed. Amen. Because we have decided to seek the Lord, we find the Lord. And the Lord will fight your cause for you. Verse 13. Now there were more than 40 who had formed this conspiracy. More than 40 people. I even said 40, but more than 40 people. 40 people binded themselves together on oath. You know what it is, oath? They initiated themselves. I don't know how they did it. And they said, we are not going to eat nor drink until Paul is dead. See? It should be temporary. This work cannot be permanent. Evil all the way. The social media is exposing so many things. People abusing 6 months old child. People killing for nonsense. People, look at what is going on in Nigeria. The henchmen, the Fulani henchmen, they are saying they will wipe out all the Christians on the land. Christianity today said thousands of Christians from January this year, thousands have been killed, mostly in the Middle Belt, in Plateau State, in Benue State. They have killed so many Christians. And mostly, according to Christianity Today news, they said mostly women and children, the vulnerable, because I know men will have run away. And they'll do this in the night. It's the evil people do. How can you? I have never seen it done. It can never happen that we wipe away Christianity. It's not possible. You cannot wipe away Christianity because it's based on the blood Jesus shed on the cross of Calvary. If you can do it, then you are saying that Jesus is not Lord. But everything must bow down for Jesus, because Jesus Christ is Lord. Every knee will confess that Jesus is Lord. You confess either as a friend of God or as an enemy of God. You must confess that Jesus is Lord. You must bow down your knees for Jesus. Either you are a Christian, you are a Muslim, you are a pagan, you are an adult worshiper, you will bow down for Jesus one day. You either bow down for Jesus to say, I thank you, I'm your servant. I have given my life to you. Or you bow down for him when you will see him, when you will not be here. Some people, they will bow down for Jesus when they get to hell, and it will have been too late. But the Bible says every knee must bow down for Jesus. Everyone born of a woman must bow down for Jesus. No matter what you think, no matter what you are saying, you either bow down for Jesus now, my brother. If you are here, you are not a Christian, you better bow down for Jesus now. Because one day, you will confess that Jesus is Lord. One day, you must bow down for Jesus. You either bow down for Jesus as a friend of God, or you bow down for Jesus as an enemy of God, when you will spend a total separation from God. Eternal damnation. It will happen. Look at history. Nobody can destroy Christianity. It's not possible. See what they are doing? What these Fulani people are doing? It's nothing. Their forefathers have done it before. They failed. Go and read the history of Usman Dafodio. Read this history. You cannot wipe away Christianity. It's not possible. Some people are saying that in this land that God has given us, we are going to remain here. There are still churches. Churches are coming up in those places where they are killing. You can't wipe out Christianity. It's not physical. It's not ordinary. You think it's ordinary? It's not. So these people, verse 14, they came to the chief priests and elders and said, we have bound ourselves under a great oath that we will eat nothing until we have killed Paul. And the others, they are very happy. Were they able to kill Paul? Paul died at God's own time. They lied, because I know after a while they will go and eat. Some of them, some of these people, they will go to the secret, they will eat and come out. I'm not eating, let's keep. They will go when they will go into secret, because if they don't eat, they're going to die. They will have no energy. More than 40 people, everyone that band themselves together against your destiny, the Lord that dealt with these people that banded themselves together against Paul, we deal with them in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Your victory is sure in the Lord, the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Whatever you are passing through is only temporary. Absolutely. For Christian, I want to conclude on this note. For Christian, for us Christian believers, let me conclude on this. Listen, for us as Christian, as believers, we always hope for the best. We always, because the best is yet to come. I'm excited. The best is yet to come. For us as Christians, it's good, better, best. It's good here now because we have hope. If only in this world we have hope. If only in this world we don't have, or we just, this is what we just have. Of all men, we are most miserable. But it is good for us because we have hope. We have hope of eternal life. My Bible tells me, we're going to read the scriptures. Check with me the scriptures, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19 says, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most miserable. So in Christ, our hope is not only in this world. But then, that is our good. Look at our better. Look at our better. When we depart this body, we shall do what? We'll be present with the Lord. So it's only temporary we're here. And that is better. 2 Corinthians 5:8. Yes, we are fully confident, and we would rather be away from these earthly bodies, for then we will be at home with the Lord. If we rather, it's better for us. So it's always win-win for Christian. You never lose. You are in this body, you are for the Lord. When you depart from this body, you are with the Lord. It's win-win, and it's better. But listen to me, even those that are away in this body, that are with the Lord, the best is yet to come. Amen? Amen. What we say? Amen. The best is yet to come for us as Christians. We see hope for our glorious body. Those that have gone, their earthly body is still here. When they will be glorified, they will pick that earthly body. Let's read the scriptures. Philippians chapter 3, verse 21. Philippians 3, 21. Who will transform our lowly body, that it may be, it will be conformed to his glorious body, according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself. The best is yet to come. Even after we departed this body and we are with him, we are still waiting for our glorious body. Because when Jesus Christ resurrected, he took his body. They went to the tomb. They can't find the body there. My dad is dead. His body may still be in the tomb now, right? The body, see, if your parents, if they are gone, their bodies will be in the tomb. If they are Christians, they are believers, their soul has gone to be with the Lord. But their body is still there. But when Christ will come in the rapture, for example, the dead in Christ will do what? They have to go and take that body. That body. How God is going to do it is a mystery, the Bible says. I don't know how he's going to do it. But we pick that body, that glorious, glorified body, and then you go and meet the Lord in the sky. And those of us that are still alive, the Bible says, in a twinkling of an eye, we must change this body to become a body that can stay with the Lord. Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews 11, we are praying. Hebrews 11, it says, verse 30 says, by faith the walls of Jericho fell down after they were encircled for 7 days. By faith the harlot Rahab did not perish. Now they begin to mention all those people, mention Samson, you know, before then he mentioned Abraham, mentioned Abel, mentioned all these people. Then when he got to look at this verse 39, look at verse 39. The best is yet to come for us, brethren. If you are not a Christian, think about Christianity, think about Christ. It's temporary here. Be serious about your Christianity. Look at verse 39 of that Hebrews chapter 11. All those people mentioned in the hall of faith. He says, and all this, all those people mentioned, those great men of faith in the hall of faith, having obtained a good testimony through faith, did not receive the promise. Why? God having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart from us. The best is yet to come for them. They're enjoying right now with the Lord, but the best is what? They cannot get it until we are with them. And that is the best is still ahead of us. The Lord will bless you in Jesus' name. Think about Jesus. I will conclude with this story. It is only temporary. If you are here, you are not a Christian, think about Christ. Give your life to Christ. Coming to church is not enough. You must be a believer. And if any man be in Christ, a new creation, all things must pass away. If you are in Christ, you are not a new creation, something is not right. Think about it. Look at this story. Alexander the Great, one of the greatest military generals who ever lived, conquered almost the entire known world with his vast army. One night, during a campaign, he couldn't sleep and left his tent to walk around the campgrounds. As he was walking, he came across a soldier asleep on guard duty. A serious offense. You sleep on duty, they must kill you. It's a serious offense in the military. At that time, I don't know now. The penalty for falling asleep on guard duty was, in some cases, instant death. The commanding officer sometimes poured kerosene on the sleeping soldier and lit it. Not just is it death, burning because he's sleeping on duty. The soldier began to wake up as Alexander the Great approached him. Recognizing who was standing in front of him, the young man feared for his life. Do you know what the penalty is for falling asleep on guard duty? Alexander the Great asked the soldier. Yes, sir. The soldier responded in a quivering voice, a fearful voice. Soldier, what's your name? He said, soldier, what's your name? Demanded Alexander the Great. Then the soldier answered, Alexander, sir. Alexander the Great repeated the question. What is your name? My name is Alexander, sir. The soldier repeated. A third time, and more loudly, Alexander the Great asked, what is your name? A third time, the soldier meekly said, my name is Alexander, sir. Alexander the Great then looked at the young soldier straight in the eye. Soldier, he said with intensity, either change your name or change your conduct. You cannot bear the same name with me and you are doing this. Change your name or you change your conduct. So many of us, I am born again, I am this, I am that. You either born again, be like Christ, or change that name, Christianity, or whatever you call yourself. Alexander said, you are bearing the same name with me and you are sleeping on duty. Change that name. Or change your behavior. Think about that. You're a Christian. You are born again. Be like Christ. Or you change that name. Don't call yourself Christian. Because you are going to dent that name. Alexander doesn't want that person to dent that name. How many of us would like it? If somebody who bears your name is called that is a criminal, would you like it? I won't like it. I like when they say Emmanuel. Like I like the Prime Minister or is it President of France? It's Emmanuel. That's kind of people. Yeah, Emmanuel. His name is what? I like Emmanuel. Yeah, Emmanuel. I'm very happy. Sometimes I work in the city. Sometimes when they want to mention, what's your name? I say Emmanuel. I say well, with double M. Amen. I like when you are Emmanuel, yeah. It's very easy to remember because the major is what? It's Emmanuel. But who wants to, who doesn't want that? If there's anybody whose name is Barack Obama now, he will go and print it wide. He will print it wide. Say, I'm from Kenya, I'm Barack Obama. But if he has done something wrong, so we want to change that name. There was a time people were changing their names when they caught some armed robbers and they were killing them, then in Nigeria, they were killing them on at the barbish. People were changing their names. Even some people that were wearing lace attire, they begin to change, they want to wear something, maybe Guinea, because they don't want to be like armed robbers. If you are a Christian, people should come with you to meet the Lord. Father, we bless you this afternoon. We worship you. It's only temporary. We thank you for the love you have for us. Thank you for not letting us go in to eat the fruit of life, that we will remain wicked, we will remain rebellious forever. But you send us out of the garden so that we can have a change. Because then it's only temporary. Afterwards, everything is temporary. We are looking forward for the best, because the best is yet to come. Father, help us, oh Father. If there's anyone here that has not given his life to you, Father, we pray that one will not have a rest in his or her spirit until he come to know you as Lord and Savior, and then be a changed person totally, and then fellowship to grow in you, that at the end of it, oh Lord, we shall all reign with you in glory. Thank you, blessed Messiah. Glory be to your name, O God. In Jesus' name we are praying. Praise the Lord.